a cow, and even less money to buy one.
And he and his wife did so wish to have one.
One day she said to her, I have had a thought. I can make us a cap out of wood and shape it
and plate
and paint it brown so that it looks like any other.
And the time will surely grow and be a cow.
So the little peasant went to work shaping and planing the cap. And he painted it brown and made it with its head hanging as if it were eating.
Do you like it?
I love it. I'll make some dinner.
Great.
The next morning, the cows were being driven out to pasture.
Good morning, cowherd. I wonder if you might take my little calf here out to pasture. She's so small, she can't walk for herself, so you'll have to carry her.
All right.
Wrap the ribbon up in the cow's bowl. on his way.
You're putting my food into your cow skin. Why is that?
Oh, well, you see, I'm feeding the fortune teller that lives in there.
What?
A fortune teller lives in his cow skin.
Yeah, speaks truth.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, can he foretell anything?
Ah, yes, but he only foretells four things.
Well, have him foretell something.
As you wish. So, the little peasant pinched the raven's head.
I'm sorry?
He says there is roast meat in the stove.
There hasn't been roast meat in the stove, or... There's roast meat in the stove!
What's more, he squeezed the raven's head. Salad in the cupboard.
The farmer went to the cupboard and opened it.
No, no, there's nothing in that cupboard.
Upon my soul, there's salad in the cupboard.
A miracle.
Once more, he squeezed the raven's head again.
Where?
Where? Wine under the pillow.
There's no pillow there at all.
The farmer went thither and found the wine. Why?
Ah. Once more, he made the raven prophecy. Sweet cakes under the bed.
Sweet cakes coming up. Sweet cakes. And the two sat down to the table to eat.
Well, by this time, the farmer's wife was a nervous wreck, so she took the keys to her hope chest and went to bed.
So, what is the fifth thing?
Fifth thing. Good question. We'd better eat the first four things.
So they ate.
And they bargained to see how much the farmer would pay for the fifth prophecy.
100 silver pieces.
Come, come, you insult me. Food is expensive.
300 silver pieces.
Done. The little peasant walked around the cottage making the raven croak here and there. Ah!
sink.
The farmer went to the chest and opened it. Stand back.
Right, stand back.
You there!
It was a big, scary monster.
The next morning, the little peasant made off with 300 silver pieces. At home, he launched out, bought himself a piece of land, and built himself a brand new cottage.
The rich peasant, seeing the little peasant's prosperity, decided that he must have been to the land where it snows gold.
And they carry it home by the shovelfuls.
We must take him before the judge.
From whence he was bidden to tell where came this newfound wealth?
Your Honor, I sold my cowskin to town for 300 silver pieces.
When the other peasants heard this, they too wished to share in this incredible profit.
So they all went home and... Sheep at the bottom of the river with their...
Oh, yes, treasure under thousands, but
I, as a mere peasant, could do nothing with it.
He led them all back to the river.
Not far! You can make it, think of the sheep.
Just at that time, there appeared in the sky white, fleecy clouds, which are sometimes called little lambs.
Would you look at that?
They were reflected in the water.
They got gills. I knew
sheep. There's a thing with a name on it.
Children.
Children, lots of them. Kids.
Hey! It is fitting, since I am your judge, that I should go in first.
Yeah!
I shall jump in, and when I find the sheep, I shall send for you with my signal.
Yeah!
Goodbye.
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 Bubble.
That's it. That's a sign. He's calling us. Let's go to the river. Let's get cheap. Let's get rich.
Bubble. So, the entire village was drawn to the river. And his wife inherited
everything.
Do you like it?
I love it. I'll make some dinner.
Great. Chasing after mice. Did you ever taste a mouse?
tree.
The cat and dog lay down.
And the rooster flew up to the top branches. And they fell asleep.
Their new house,
and they never had to leave it again.
story's over.
Is he stars?
No!
Sorry to scare you like that, folks. But it's important to note right off the bat that this coming up scene is incredibly, incredibly scary.
Very good.
I'm not going to give it away right away. I'll give you a hint, though. Right there, this entire... See where I flashed my leg? That's a graveyard. Think about it. Think of all the dead, rotting flesh mere meters away from the And a graveyard right around midnight, I believe. And I'll tell you, many a scary thing has been known to happen in a graveyard around midnight. And so if any of you feel impelled to let out a blood-curdling, bone-chilling scream, feel free to go ahead, because your neighbors will be doing exactly the same thing. This is my luck. It's Wednesday. No, what day is this? It's Friday. It's Friday, of course. Friday, midnight, it's Texas Chainsaw Massacre 3. At the Uptown, a midnight showing of Texas Chainsaw Massacre 3. I don't have anything to eat, so why am I supposed to do it? Maybe if I had a bag of walnuts. What would you suggest? What's really good to eat at a theater? A really skip pizza? Pizza? Perhaps pizza? Maybe. Mutton! Mutton! That's it. Mutton! And walnuts browning.
Jimmy, is that you?
Andy! Andy, what are you doing here?
Well, I'm taking a shortcut through this graveyard over the little peasant's farm. Nope.
You really rookie in the last scene.
Yeah, 300 silver pieces.
Who would have thought?
Oh, I can't believe I was that dumb.
Well, don't blame yourself. So what do you plan to do there?
Well, I'm going to go get myself you know he's got that big flock of sheep, right? Well, I'm going to go over there, and I'm going to get myself the fattest sheep you have ever seen.
Now, Andy, this may just be a coincidence, but at the Uptown, they were showing a midnight movie. It's a Texas Chainsaw Massacre 3. And I was thinking, you know, I was going to go and bring something to eat. Now, if you're going to go get a sheep, I'll tell you what, I'm here in this graveyard. My mother died yesterday.
Yeah,
I know, it's okay. I don't know. But, you see, underneath her head, she had buried this huge bag of walnuts.
Walnuts?
Walnuts, I know. It's a crazy thing to do, but
I love walnuts.
I'll tell you what, here's a good idea. I'll go and get the walnuts. You go get a big fat sheep and meet me back here in the cover of darkness. And we'll go to the movie and have a great time.
Yeah, awesome.
And you're going to have to sneak that sheep in your coat, because they do not allow food in there. You got to get the walnuts there.
So, walnuts? Sheep? Hey!
Big fat one.
Yeah, hey, we'll pick up some hot peasant babes.
Peasant babes, sheep, and walnuts.
What could you
do? Yeah, you bet.
So the man went forward and began to dig up his mother's grave. He took the walnuts to the porch of the church, where he began to eat them.
It was the custom of the sexton to pass through the churchyard on his way to ring the midnight hour.
Thank you.
bridegroom does come along, I give him my daughter.
One day a suitor did come, and he appeared to be rich.
And seeing as the miller could buy nothing wrong with the man, he promised his daughter to him.
The maiden, however, did not like him as a bride ought to like her bridegroom, nor had she any faith in him. Whenever she looked at him or thought about him, a shudder came over her.
One day he said to her,
"You are my betrothed, and yet you never come and see me."
"But I don't even know where your house is."
He pointed in the direction of his home, there, in the depths of the forest.
She made excuses and said she could not find the way.
"Sunday I'll be having many friends come over. You must come too. I'll strew some ashes to guide your way."
The daughter curtsied to her bridegroom, and he left, saying,
"Sunday, don't forget."
When Sunday came, the maiden was frightened, but she did not know why. She filled her pockets with peas and lentils and set out. At the entrance of the forest, she found the trail of ashes and followed them. But every step or two, she scattered peas and lentils to her left and to her right, so she might find her way back again. She walked and walked all day, until she reached the middle of a forest where it was almost dark. There, she saw a solitary house. It was dark and dismal. She went inside. There was no one about. And there was dead silence. Suddenly a voice cried,
turn back, thou bonny bride, nor in this house of death abide."
The voice came from a bird in a cage. Again it cried,
turn back, thou bonny bride, nor in this house of death abide."
She ran from room to room, but they were all dark and dismal. At last she reached the cellar, and there she found
an old woman, a slave to the robber's window.
"Does my bridegroom live here?"
"Alas, my poor child, you do not know where you are. You are a murderer's name. You came here for marriage, but death broke your marriage. Come, look, I have filled this kettle full of water, and when they return, they will kill you without mercy, cut you into pieces, cook you, and eat you. For they who live in this house are eaters of human flesh, unless I take pity on you, who are lost."
"That's them. Quickly, my dear, hide behind this cask of wine."
"No! Wait! No!"
The robbers returned, bringing with them a maiden.
peas and lentils had taken root, shot up, and showed them the way in the moonlight. They walked and walked all night, and in the morning, when they reached the mill, she told her father all she had been through.
However, the next day was the day of the wedding. The miller had invited all of his friends and relations.
Oh, welcome. How are you? Welcome to my home.
Good afternoon.
And he passed the afternoon enjoyably telling familiar tales.
So, you graced my home with your presence. So, they lived happily ever after.
And it turned out it was just a cow.
And so, my story ends.
And the maiden was never heard from again. Come, my love. You've been so quiet. Now it is your turn to tell us a story.
I will tell you a dream I've had. I dreamt I was walking in a wood, and I came upon a house where not a soul was to be seen. A bird hung in a cage. It cried, turn back, thou bonny bride, nor in this house of death abide. It's only a dream, my love. Then I ran from room to room, but they were all dark and dismal. At last I reached the cellar, and there I found an old woman with a shaking head. Does my bridegroom live here, I asked. Alas, poor child, you are in a murderer's den. Your bridegroom does indeed live here, but he will cut you to pieces, cook you, and eat you. My love, this is only a dream. Then the old woman hid me behind a cask, and no sooner had she done so when the murderers returned home, dragging with them a maiden. They gave her three glasses of wine to drink. One was white, one was red, and one was yellow. After drinking them, the maiden fell dead. This is only a dream, my love. Then, one of the murderers saw a ring on the girl's little finger, and since he could not pull it off, he took an axe and he cut it off. The finger bounded into the air and fell behind the cask and into my lap. But alas, this was no dream. Here's the finger with the ring.
At seeing this, the bridegroom turned pale as ashes and tried to escape.
Return to the safety of our father's home.
Now this alone may not have been strange.
But when I overheard,
kangaroo whispered
to
no one in particular.
Hare has lost his spectacles.
Well,
he began to wonder.
Presently,
the moon appeared
from behind the clouds.
And there,
lying on the grass,
was Hare
in the stream
that floated by the grass.
Was mute.
And sitting astride
a twig of bush was me.
Seemingly motionless,
Hare was,
in fact,
trembling with excitement.
For without his spectacles,
he was completely helpless.
Where were his spectacles?
Could someone have stolen them?
Had he mislaid them?
What was he to do?
Me wanted to have.
And thinking she had.
The answer. You probably ate them, thinking they were a carrot.
No.
Interrupted.
Ow.
Was.
Wise. As one with good eyesight, insight, and foresight, I must ask how intelligent Hare could make such a silly mistake.
But all the time,
ow,
had been on the fence, scowling.
Kangaroo
was
hopping mad
at this
sort of talk.
She thought herself
far superior
to the others
in intelligence.
She was
their leader,
their guru.
She had the answer.
Hare must go in search of the optician.
But then she realized
the hare
was completely helpless
without his spectacles.
So she loudly proclaimed,
I can't send Hare in search of anything.
You can, Guru, you can.
Shouted
Newt. You can send him with Owl.
But,
oh,
gone.
To sleep.
Newt.
Newt.
Too much.
To be stopped by so small a problem.
You can take him in your pouch.
But,
alas,
Hare was
much too big
to fit
into Kangaroo's pouch.
All this time it had been quite plain
to Hare
that the others
knew nothing about his spectacles.
And as for all their attempted ideas, well, Hare did not care. The spectacles were his own affair. After all, Hare did have a spare pair.
What?
Oh. Yeah, sir, about this.
Just
yeah, right, yeah. What?
That's the stupidest story I've ever heard in my life.
So stupid, it's actually
you
smart.
You are so weird. What, were you raised by wolves or something?
Oh, wolfing. Oh,
the wolfing.
Everybody, you know, get up and stretch, and you know, there's coffee and refreshments and all kinds of great stuff up there. I'll see you in about 50 minutes, okay? Wish me luck. Bye.
From the word, when suddenly a splendidly dressed man on a beautiful horse came riding up.
The well-dressed man stepped down.
What do you want?
I want nothing but for once to enjoy a simple peasant meal. Please cook for me some potatoes in the way that you always have them, and I shall sit and dine with you.
You are a count, or a prince, or perhaps even a duke. But gentlemen often have such fancies. You shall have your wish.
And the woman went inside to prepare the meal.
And the old man led him into his garden, where he began tying up young trees to posts. The old man took a young tree, put it into a hole, and drove a post beside it. And when he had shoveled in some earth and packed it down firmly, he tied the stalk of the tree above, below, and in the middle, fast to the post by a rope of straw.
Good father, have you no children who could help you with your work?
No, it is true. I had a son once, sharp, knowing, full of bad tricks. But he ran off, and I haven't heard from him since.
What of this old twisted tree here? Why don't you tie a stake to it so that it, too, may grow straight like the others?
Sir, you speak according to your knowledge, but it is obvious you know nothing about trees. It is too late for an old tree. You have to start out with the young.
Hmm. Perhaps that's how it was with your son. If you had trained him while he was young, he may not have run away.
I don't know.
Perhaps. Would you know him if you were to see him again?
Not by his face.
No? Well, how then?
I don't know. He had a mark about him.
A mark? What sort of mark?
A birthmark.
Where was it?
On his neck.
What did it look like?
It was in the shape of a bean.
A bean? Then the stranger showed the old man his neck.
Yes! That's it! Sandballer!
from the rich, I'm a master thief.
A thief is still a thief! And if your godfather, the Count in the castle, hears of this, he will not hold you as fondly as he did when he baptized you. He will hang you from the nearest altar!
Be easy, Father. I've learned not to it well. I'm going to see him this evening.
So the old man took him to his mother.
When she found out he was her son, she wept for joy.
But when he revealed himself as a thief,
a second stream flowed down her face. Still, he's my son. My eyes have beheld him once more. And they went inside to eat the meal that he had not eaten in so long.
That night, the master thief rode to see the Count.
The Count received him civilly, for he took him to be a distinguished man.
But when the stranger revealed himself as a godson and a thief,
the Count turned pale and was silent for some time. You are my godson, and therefore mercy shall take the place of justice. Since you pride yourself on being a thief, I will put your heart to the proof. But I warn you, if you do not stand the test, you will be hanged, and the crooking of the rain will be your music on the occasion.
Lord Count, three tasks, as difficult as you may, and if I do not complete them, do with me what you will.
You shall steal from out of the stable the horse I keep for my own riding.
Nothing simpler.
And you shall steal from my bed a sheet and the wedding ring of my wife.
Done.
And from out of the church you will steal the parson and the sexton.
Done and done.
Mark what I am saying, for your life depends upon it.
That night, the master thief donned the garments of an old woman. Onto his face he painted the wrinkles of age into a cask of fine Hungarian wine he carried. He mixed a powerful sleeping potion. And again placing the cask on his back, with slow and tottering steps, he made his way to the castle of the Count.
Oh! Who goes there?
Oh, it's only an old woman.
You've got your cask, old mother.
A cask of fine Hungarian wine.
Whoa!
I live by trade. For money and kind words, I am more than willing to let you have a glass. Thank you.
Me too. Well, since I haven't got any money, I'll give you a kiss for my wine.
How nice. Double the portions for you, my dear.
Entered his courtyard.
to the gallows. There, he discovered the body of a poor sinner, hanged for thievery. Cutting the body down, he proceeded to place it on his back and make his way to the castle of the Count. Once there, place the ladder up against the Count's window, and again, putting the body on his back, made his way up to listen outside the window.
Inside the castle, the Count and the Countess were preparing for bed. The Countess held the hand with the ring tightly. Do you think the thief will come?
Yes, all the doors are locked, and if he comes through this window, I will shoot the thief.
Hearing this, the master thief pushed the body up so the head showed in the window.
The Count, who was watching in bed, fired a pistol at him. Boom!
The master thief watched the body falling into the garden below. And hit himself in the head.
I have shot the thief.
Are you sure?
Yes, he's lying there dead. I must go and bury him.
No, no, please send one of the guards.
Stay here and remain calm.
You always say that.
Master Thief noticed particularly how the Count got out the window and down the steps. Taking this in mind, he entered the dimly lit bedroom.
Dear wife!
What's up with thee?
I've shot my own godson.
Don't feel sad.
I feel better now, but he deserves a proper burial. Give me the sheet so as I might wind his body in it.
You mustn't reproach yourself.
I don't.
So they folded the sheet together.
Yes. Thank you. Oh, yes, wife, I've had a fit of generosity come over me, seeing as how the thief so wanted your ring. Give it to me so I might bury it.
She would never disobey her husband, so she unwillingly withdrew it from her finger and gave it to him.
Thank you. The master thief made off with these items. Dear wife.
How did it go? Are you okay?
Where is the sheet?
Oh, you came. Got it.
Did no such
thing. Yeah, you did.
I see he took your ring as well.
Well, it
Is there a room?
Yes.
count. The next morning, the count, hearing a ruckus of his pigeon coop, went to investigate.
Seeing him, the master thief cut open the sack. Shree! Heaven!
Oh, I love the angels.
Hello!
Ah!
You made it too! My dear friends, this is not heaven.
No, this is heaven.
Heaven is a lot cleaner.
What?
I'm sorry.
That's a good
point. Might as well get back to the church where you're needed. You are an arch thief, and you have won your wager. But see to it that you leave my land at once, for if you ever set foot in it again, you can count on your elevation to the galleries.
Thank you. Have a wonderful time.
Ooh, ritual.
The master thief took leave of this country and went out into the wide, wide world and has never been heard from since.
Why? Husband, you can't
catch anything today?
No, all I caught was one fish, and he said he was an enchanted prince, so I threw him back.
And you did not wish for anything?
No, why would I do that?
Is it not bad enough we have to live in this wretched, filthy hovel?
I like it.
You might have at least wished for a nice, clean cottage. Go back to the flounder. Tell him I want a nice, clean cottage.
No, wife. Why would I go back there?
Was it not you who caught him and let him go again? Well, he will certainly grant you that. Now go!
Okay.
The man was still not very willing to go, but he did not want to vex his wife, so he returned to the sea. When he reached the sea, he found it no longer bright and shining, but dull and green.
Why, the sea is dull and green.
Flounder, flounder in the sea, prithee hearken unto me. Isabel, my willful wife, does not want my way of life.
Shark! 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 Stop barbing at the bottom of the food chain, I'll tell you. Oh, what can I do for you today?
Flounder, my wife says that seeing as how I was the one who caught you, and I let you go, I should have wished for something.
Very well, what would you have?
She wants a nice, clean cottage.
Sounds reasonable. Go home. She has her wish fully.
Thanks.
Baby beluga in the deep blue sea.
So remain. You and I shall live happily in this little cottage.
Well, we shall see about that. And with that, he ate something and went to bed. Husband, wake up.
Let it so remain. You and I shall live happily in this stone palace.
What?
And with that, they went to bed.
Go to the founder and tell him I want to be lord of the universe.
Wife,
My wife wants to be Lord of the Universe.
You mean God?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's just great. Why can't you just once ask me to come up here, have a drink, play some cards? I'm always asking for these.
I haven't had a decent night's sleep in over a week!
Oh, it's okay. It's okay.
I'm stressed!
I understand. You're married, a bad one. I'm sorry, fisherman. This time it cannot be. Now you must go back to your hovel by the sea. Look at that, not even a ripple. Just after I wax my board. It's been a slice. Don't be afraid to call on me if you want to have a beer or something. I'll be just waiting.
Hey,
take care, Cheesy.
Perhaps.
Take care, fisherman. Let's go surf now! Everybody learn it now! Come on, surf party with me!
The wife was a fisherman who lived with his wife in a rundown shack by the sea. And every day he'd go fishing in the briny deep. And he'd sit there fishing, about half asleep. And he'd fish, and he'd fish, and he'd fish.
Youngest of those, called Simpleton.
He was scorned and despised by the others.
And always kept in the background.
Go on, get him back.
Sit down.
Shut up. I'm going to work.
One day, the oldest son went out into the forest to cut some wood.
But before he left...
Right.
His mother got him a bottle of wine and some sweet cake, so that he might not suffer from hunger or thirst along his way.
Thanks, Mom. Jeez, I always do that. So he set out into the forest.
But suddenly there was a little brown man.
Good afternoon, kind young sir. I was wondering if you might have, maybe a piece of cake, and perhaps a drop of wine. To share with a hungry and thirsty old man?
Well, I suppose if I share some of my wine with the other, perhaps some of my cake, I guess I wouldn't have enough for myself, so,
Get off with ya! Get out of here! People.
The little brown man left quickly, but the first son had his punishment coming to him.
The oldest son was not long at work before he made a false stroke.
Was not long delayed.
few strokes, he struck his own leg.
Four!
next morning, Simpleton and the goose set off into the forest.
Good morning.
Not noticing the two girls step on behind.
Sunny days.
In the middle of two fields, they met upon.
Surprise!
Shame on you two young girls chasing after that young man like that. Come away, or I'll have to pull you away. As soon as you got on, he's out. You stop fast.
Sweep me up. Clouds of gray.
Very soon they passed by the church. Good morning, parsons.
Come here, we have a christening this afternoon.
On my way, but that's it.
Two peasants walking down the road saw the hilarious bunch.
So the king proclaimed that whomever could make his daughter laugh should marry her.
But he knew it must be a fine play, and one that could involve a goodly number of students.
that it must appeal to a wide audience, that it must be a play with strenuous acting challenges, and that in its performance it must be of a quality as would befit this, the finest high school in the land. In time, he settled upon the play Story Theater by Paul Sills, a collection of traditional children's stories mainly from the Brothers Grimm. And so it was done. The man began working on the play late in February and concluded last weekend. For his production, he was blessed to find an amazingly strong cast and a hard-working one. And these were them. In the roles of Little Peasant, Gullible Sexton, Man with a Cat, Fisherman, and Simpleton, he cast the marvelously talented and rubber-bodied grade 10 comedian Justin Lambert. In the roles of Dutiful Wife, Dog, Betrothed Maid, Cat, Wanton Airheaded Sister Number One, he cast the lovely and capable grade 12 student, Pam Lockton. In the roles of Cowherd, Old Woman, Venus, the Goddess of Love, Fisherman's Wife, and Helpful Mother, he cast grade 12, Kim Johnson. Judge, Dopey Butt Robber Number Two, Drunken Parson, Vile Robber Number Three, Nasty Son Number One, and Master Thief. He cast a student whose only error in life was to not come to this school until his grade 11 year, but he's here, Brett Manlock. Wanton Airheaded Sister Number Two, as the grade 12 student Rachel Copins. In the roles of Lusty Parson, Drunken Grave Robber, Vile Robber Number One, Count, and Enchanted Flounder, he cast Jamie McKenzie. In the roles of Cat with a Face as Long as a Wet Week, Betrothed Maiden, Exasperated Narrator, and Snorting Princess, he cast thoroughly bizarre, designedly talented, grade 10 student Colleen Sharp. Shepherd, Rooster, Vile Robber Number Two, Long Lost Father, and Little Brown Man. Cast the Spring Loaded, Grade 12, Gerald Scott. Finally, to organize his actors, to light and give sound to the play, the man had Grade 12, Brian Forland, provide his invaluable services. Because the man was largely incapable of organizing a drunken brewery, he was grateful in the extreme to Brian Forland. As things turned out, audiences were no less pleased by the play than was the man himself, and all called the show a great success for this, the finest high school in the land. The only real discomfort the man felt was in having to select recipients for the 1990 Chameleon Theatre Awards for Excellence in Drama. After much consideration, he chose to make two special mentions. The first was to a student who over 2 years had shown great dedication to the drama department, worked both as a performer, as a stage manager, as a light sound technician, and always with as much energy as he could possibly muster, Mr. Brian Forland. Recipient of the second special mention, he chose a student who, though he opted not to take Reverend 2830, still participated in two extracurricular shows, and over that time showed the greatest improvement in voice, movement, timing, and believability. Jamie McKenzie. The man's hardest task was in choosing a recipient for the Principal Award for Excellence in Drama, because he knew that all of his actors were in some way worthy of this award. In time, though, he decided to give it to a student who, over 3 years, had shown immense dedication and energy to the department, who participated in no less than 3 extracurricular shows, had suffered and beautifully through all 3 levels of the band's drama program, who showed great skill in many areas of performance as a writer, as a musician, as a dancer, most importantly, as an actress, and who was always a genuine inspiration and a very good friend to everybody, Miss Pam Laughlin.
Mr. Verstegen, who was very busy expecting a little baby that arrived just before our zone meet, and I really appreciated his help throughout the season. We also have the pleasure of recognizing some individuals, a male athlete and a female athlete. This year I was fortunate enough not to have to choose between my 2 female athletes that I felt were the most dedicated. They were out consistently, did very, very well. And those 2 were Shannon Hebert and Christy Forster. Track and field is unfortunately not here tonight. That was Kelly Corpany, who dedicated a lot of time to the track and field meet. So congratulations to Kelly. Thank you.
Airhead.
I know.
Ariel.
It was actually
Ariel View, eh?
One of them
There we go.
Is it really working?
Yes. See the red light? The red light, that means it's working.
So if we look to your top...
1990 Drama Award recipient, Pam Lachlan. And this,
well, me, what am I?
This is her chief music.
You're a wanted airhead.
I'm a wanted airhead.
Number two, number one.
Wanted. No, I'm wanted.
I'm a wanted airhead.
And some other... Hey, no, that's... She won. It's somewhere... There it is.
Hey, she also got another award.
Oh, she got another award, too. She's awesome. And then Rachel's awesome, too. Justin's pretty cool. And hey, there's someone hiding behind there.
Look at Gerald videotaping everybody.
Hey, hi, Jen. How's it going? Oh, boy. Whoa, hey. Hey, whoa, hey. That's... Hey, what? Oh, my God.
Wow. Take off or...
Living skyscraper there. Yeah.
Do you have to work today?
I know
you guys...
No. Oh. No, I just... I dressed...
I recognize the attire, I'm thinking.
Oh, thank you. Hmm. Who could it be? Where's... Hi. How are you, Kelly?
I'm great.
That's good.
Oh, jeez. I'm going to get in my car.
I
appreciate you getting on my seat. Just about I parked this far away from the building.
Do it. Justin, where are my other friends? Miss D. Champlain, how are you? Hey, isn't that kind of, what do you call that? No, I'm just kidding.
Don't put a camera on me, I go,
You look at something.
Oh, Kim. Hi, Kim. How are you?
I'm fine, Joe.
Ah, there's Carmen.
Oh my God. Yeah.
Oh well, gonna have to be signing off here.
Yeah.
See you later.
Bye.
Hey, Joan.
Piece of paper.
How you doing? Over here, Joan. You're looking pretty awesome there. Hey, no, come on, get in the camera there.
You're getting
it. Hi, Serena, how are you?
Okay, enough with the video.
Hi,
I'm gonna shove that thing in here.
Rachel, that's a.
Can't see now. Mm. That's where. Don't you dare.
Oh, hi, April. Hi, how could I miss you?
Thank you.
Oh. Colleen? How are you?
For the closing words and appreciation, Mr. Crookton.
Senior girls volleyball, our school coaches, Madam